JP.
Yes, I have a problem with my camera. Just a moment.
Every time I see Sebi twice on the panel, I know that something might be wrong. But no.
Can you hear my voice?
We can hear your voice and you can see,
Yes.
we can also see your beautiful photograph.
Yes, but I don't know why my camera doesn't work.
We can see your wonderful green eyes, but we prefer to see them, you know, live. I mean, we want to see the way you look, not only a frozen image. Come on, frozen image is not enough.
The problem is that he still has a coolest background than we
Don't know
do.
why
Yeah.
does not work.
Oh,
Very, very strange. Let me tell you, very, very, very strange.
Hey, you know, these Macintosh computers that you are using are full of technical problems. You should go back to the Windows, you know, with them. Do you remember
Yes,
the noise?
probably.
Do you remember the
Probably.
noise? And
Emilio, what are you
Senti,
doing?
esci e rientri. Esci e rientri che faccio partire la sigla.
Italian in intervine.
Yeah.
Cool.
So, in the meanwhile, welcome everybody from all over the world in the third episode of season two of the Demoscopy Happy Hour. Hello, send us if you like in the chat a message from saying hi from where you're coming from. So I already see Nigeria, Norway, Italy. Somebody thanking me for something which let me read it. The wide and wide follicles. Wonderful. Argentina, Romania, Austria, Uzbekistan, United States, Serbia, Spain, UK, Albania, France, Chile. Wow. Oh my God. This is wonderful. Greece, Romania, Slovenia, Poland, Holland, Lithuania, Turkey. Come
Yeah,
on. Hey.
Now, also from Napoli.
Ragazzi, ragazzi, how much I missed you last week. Did you miss me?
Come on,
so much.
We miss you.
Ragazzi, do you love me?
We
No.
love you.
Thank you.
Yes, of
Words
course.
are not
I
enough to describe our love.
love
More
you
than that.
too. Okay, Sebi, go to the jingle.
Another Sunday, time for happy hour. Thermoscopy, wine and whiskey sour. Live from Napoli to Thessaloniki. Raise your glass and join the happy hour. Raise your glass and join the happy hour. People, welcome to the show. Let me present you the love of my life, Manuel Reyes from Cordoba. And this one could become the love of your life. The PhotoFinder ATV Master, we packed it in a winter deal. It's now or never. Impossible not to get it, okay? People, check the link down here. See the offer. You will like it. Enjoy the show. And thanks for being online on such a Sunday evening. Love that. See you soon.
He's incredible.
No, that's fantastic. I didn't know it. Wait,
I haven't listened to it before either.
Basta, basta.
Very good. Very good
It's funny.
start, my
It's
friends.
funny that
Very
in the
good
video,
start, my friends.
it's funny
I have
that.
a, let me tell you, let me share with you this wine. I love this wine. I tasted first time in I don't remember where, but I suppose I was in Sicily, and I got in love for a Chardonnay from
Planeta, Planeta.
Planeta. Yeah,
Yeah.
And you like you lo you you know it.
Of course.
Ah, you know everything. Come
But
on.
we dr Jeppy, we drank it many times together.
Really?
Yes.
Ah.
I can reassure you. But it doesn't matter.
Really?
Eventually it touched you.
Well, but you know, without the bias of your teaching, I was able to enjoy it anyhow, you know? And
yeah, you know, guys, do you know that I do private lessons to Geppi on wine tasting?
Yes, but I'm a very bad student. I'm a very bad student. I cannot recall even the basics, you know? Not even the basics.
You forgot that you drank the wine together. I mean...
Okay, guys, so let me just introduce very briefly the topic of today, which is our beloved Spitznebus. Hey, we like it so much. I'm very passionate about Spitznebi. And let's start with the question of the week. Sebi, how many Spitznebi do you see in a year? 0, less than 10, or more than 10? 0, maybe it's quite depressive in some way.
But I mean, Geppi, come on. There are much more interesting questions to discuss about Spitznebi. For example, my beloved question is, yes, do you think that Spitznebus and Reednebus are the same tumor or different? Oh, that's a wonderful question.
This is a wonderful philosophic question, right? But Nisa, how are you?
Thank you, Geppi. And great to see you. And how was your trip last week?
Yes, it was very good. Just a trip back to Napoli. That's very, very sad on a Sunday evening, by the way. And Costantino, are you in Athens or where are you?
Yes, I am in Athens.
Okay,
I have that virtual background. Otherwise, you would see the New York painting that you always make fun of.
Okay, Sebi, let us know how. Less than 10 is definitely the most voted option. Mm-hmm. More than 10, by the way, is 38 out of 200, more or less 200 people, and only 8 declared 0. Only 8 of our friends declared zero.
Obviously, there is something epidemiological because, I mean, for me, the number would be 100.
For me as well.
So there's...
Of course, it depends also where you work. If
you're
in a general dermatology clinic, then it's more rare. If you're just working in a pigment deletion clinic, of course, this number is going to be much higher. But let me...
There's a bias, but I think I have a feeling that Mediterranean countries are a little bit more prone to having Spitznebus. Yeah. Nisa, how many...
Yes.
I think I have more than 100 cases and very interesting cases. But once when I talked with Cliff and Jeff Kerr from Australia, and they said that Spitznebus is extremely rare in Australia.
Yeah.
Extremely. Yeah.
True. Definitely true. Benissimo. Sebi became so talented in this work, in this job, you know?
No, talented he was anyhow. Now he's also experienced.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, you're right. Sebino, ciao. So, Sebi, do you give me the possibility to share? Yes, can I? Not yet, Sebi. I'm sorry, Sebi. Oh, here we are. So, I'm going to present you the paper of the week, which is, of course, as you can imagine, a paper related to Spitznebi. Unfortunately, this paper was not published in DPC. Emilio, that's your fault.
Yeah.
I tell you, that's your fault.
I will
tell you why it's his fault. So let's speak about Spitz. What is the problem with Spitznebi? Or let's say with Spitzoid looking lesions in general. The problem is very simple. On one side, in a proportion of Spitznebi, let's say 10 to 20% of Spitznebi, they look like melanoma. No question. This is a 4-year-old boy with a lesion which is morphologically very similar to a melanoma. But indeed, it's a Spitznebus. Okay? So 10 to 20% of Spitz nevi are looking like melanoma, okay? But this is only one side of the problem. The second side of the problem is that a certain proportion of melanomas, they look like Spitz nevi. Look at this lesion on the right. I mean, this is unbelievable, unbelievable. Eh? This is the prototype of the beautiful Spitz nevus, but instead it's not a Spitz nevus, it's a melanoma in situ. And we, of course, we can realize that these are, let's say, more probably a melanomas and not Spitz nevi, is based on the age. If we see this lesion, this belongs to a three-year-old boy. And of course, the probability here that this lesion is not a Spitz nevus but a melanoma is zero, okay? But this lesion belongs to a 53-year-old female, and the lesion is located on the leg. So this is, of course, increasing the chance that this could be a melanoma and not a Spitz nevus. Of course, this is a long-standing knowledge. Can you imagine? That's why this is one of the reasons I'm very passionate about Spitz nevi, because already in 1999, we realized that there is a certain proportion of melanomas that they belong, that they are exactly similar to Spitz nevi. And this was the first case we got in our practice. But of course, nowadays, together with Emilio, we know also the probability that a spitzoid-looking lesion is not a Spitz nevus, but it's a melanoma. And this probability is increasing by the increasing age of the patient, meaning that if you have a patient with a spitzoid-looking lesion, an elderly patient, more than 60 years of age, the probability is so high, is 79%. Can you imagine? Is unbelievable. It's 32. So one out of three of spitzoid-looking lesions are melanomas. And this is belonging to the age between 50 and 60. And then, of course, it's decreasing until before puberty, which the number is zero. Okay? So we know more or less everything now. And that's why this is the paper I wanted to show you very briefly, which is an update on dermoscopy of Spitz / Reed nevi and management guidelines by the International Dermoscopy Society, published by Emilio on behalf, of course, of the International Dermoscopy Society, quite recently, not very recently, but quite recently. And this is the algorithm for the management proposed in this paper. So if you meet a spitzoid-looking lesion in your practice, you have to first analyze if the lesion is symmetric or not. If it's not symmetric, excision, okay? Independently from the age. If it's symmetric, then you look at the age. And of course, you excise or closely monitor a lesion which is belonging to a patient after puberty, more than 12 years of age. If the patient is before puberty, is aged less than 12 years, then you have to look for the palpability of the lesion. And if it's nodular, you just excise, of course, even in a prepuberal child. Or you close monitor, of course. You always have the second chance. But if the lesion is flat, and you are dealing with a flat spitzoid-looking lesion in a patient before puberty, you have to look at the morphology in dermoscopy. If you find a typical starburst pattern, you can follow up the lesion. And if during the follow-up you see that the lesion is changing symmetrically, you follow up until stabilization. But if not, you excise it. So if the follow-up is not convincing and the lesion is changing asymmetrically, you excise, or of course, closely monitor. Any other spitzoid looking patterns like globular or negative network or pink pattern of spitzoid looking lesions, all other patterns should be more carefully evaluated. So then either excised or closely monitored. Okay, so let me just summarize all this. You, Emilio, knows that I like very much the algorithms, but you know, I see that in the practice, it's not very easy to, you know, to arrange your brain in thinking about this. I would like to summarize in this way. If you look at the lesion, which is showing a typical starburst pattern like this one top left, or a typical non-pigmented pattern of a spitzoid looking lesion, the management is age dependent, meaning that usually we like to excise those lesions after puberty and we like to monitor these lesions before puberty. But all the rest, so for lesions which are of course looking like a melanoma, like the one top bottom left, or nodular spitzoid looking lesions, we prefer to excise them independently from the age of the patient. Okay? And that's it, my guys. Do you agree?
There is a relevant question, Geppi, that yes. I tell you directly by Alberto, saying that we suggest that nodules should be excised even in childhood. But what about the scenario that you have a lesion which is not yet really nodular, but it's neither flat, so it's palpable somehow? So how can we deal with it, with this scenario?
In my view, we can take a little bit of time to monitor a little bit, just to make sure that the lesion is remaining slightly palpable and it's not becoming nodular. So once it's becoming clearly nodular, then it's time for excision.
Then there is also another question. So no spitzoid melanoma before puberty? No, this is not what Geppi said. Spitzoid melanoma does exist before puberty. Of course, it's extremely rare, but it does exist. What we say is that a symmetric spitzoid-looking lesion before puberty, especially when it's flat, has practically zero chances to be a melanoma.
But zero chances.
Spitzoid melanoma does exist, but it will be a nodular lesion with a morphology convenient to compatible with melanoma.
The point why we are going to excise nodular spitzoid looking lesions before puberty as well, also not only after puberty, but also before puberty, is exactly for this particular reason, because the rare cases of atypical, so-called atypical spitz tumors, or the even more exceptional cases of spitzoid melanomas, they usually are nodular spitzoid looking lesions. That's why we built up this kind of management guideline.
Evelyn asks, if in any case we excise after 12, then why not excise everything and end of the story and finish the story there? Well, because in childhood, first of all, spitz nevi are very frequent. Second, in childhood, in early childhood, in order to excise the spitz nevi, you might need to do general anesthesia because the child is not collaborating. So, and also because we like to save and avoid as many excisions as possible. And in this age group, we have data suggesting that we can be more conservative. But in any case, it's not a mistake, of course, to excise the spitz nevus even in early.
This is very reasonable what Evelina said. But of course, as you said, why to send a two-year-old boy, you know, like the one I showed before, to the pediatric surgeon, you know, to have this kind of surgery with at least sedation, when we can avoid it, because I mean, in this particular scenario, the chance that we are doing a mistake is zero. So,
one question. Go ahead, ask the questions from the audience and I will ask my question about your part.
Sure. There are two questions about the frequency of follow-up. When you decide to follow up in a child, how often should you do it? Well, depends how often you want to put yourself in a stressful situation, if you like to do it.
Let me tell you, it depends from the mother.
From the mother.
If the mother is a strong lady, every 6 months, not more. If the mother is more relaxed, even every 12 months, but no, let's say reasonably 6 months, I think it's, It's maybe more logical.
Yeah, maybe at the beginning you might decide to do a shorter follow-up in order to understand the dynamic of the lesion. Mm-hmm. So in the paper we say 4 months or something like this until stabilization. Spitznevi of the scalp, which is the most frequent pattern.
Very rare in my experience.
I've never seen.
On the scalp, on the face a lot. And the most frequent pattern is the nodular, pink nodular. But on the scalp, quite rare.
I think that I have one case right now, developing now. I will share the results with you once it will be excised because it's looking really, really ugly.
Okay.
12-year-old girl. But I will keep you updated once I have the results. Mm-hmm. So my question was, how often, because for me, it's often the scenario that you will see a patient, you will reassure, it's spitznevus, you'll tell the parents that it will grow, we expect it to grow. Often it will grow to become quite ugly, we know that. And the parent is, because they see the lesion growing, they will go to get another dermatologist's opinion. And the other dermatologist will see that, and they will say, how could the other dermatologist leave that on your child?
That's true.
At the end, it ends up being excised. Not that we know it's a spitznevus. However, I over the years, I tend to become a little bit more aggressive in excisions because I know that it will end up like that. And I also know that the parents will undergo a tremendous stress. So excising it when it's small with a punch and reassuring the parents is, I tend to do that way more than I used to. I have to.
Yeah, makes sense. But let me propose the following, guys, since we for sure are running late, but it's okay, we know it. The topic is one of the hottest.
Quite important.
Let us do the cases and then we'll come back to the discussion.
Yes. Okay, cool.
Everything is together. So I start first, Konstantinos, and you continue.
So cases
of the week. There we go. One easy, one difficult. Okay? Mm-hmm. We start with easy. Easy case. Sebastiano, are you ready, please? Please get ready. So, 8 years old, clinical dermoscopy. And the question is, so what do you do? Nothing, follow up, excise, pretend that you didn't see it, send to another doctor. Don't laugh.
Pretend
it's an option.
You didn't see it.
This is an option. You just, I mean,
it's a very good option.
And you continue. I didn't see. Yeah, that's an option. Yeah. Okay, let's see the results. I think follow up. 80% follow up. 80%. And now I am so good to give to this 80% what they asked for.
Yes.
To ask for follow up. I'm gonna give you, my friends, the follow up. By the way, what you voted is perfectly in line with the guidelines that JP presented. So everything is fine. So you asked for a follow-up. So there you go. It's a quite short-term follow-up. That's the clinical. I don't know how it makes you feel.
Uncomfortable.
I thought they are two different lesions. Instead, no.
No, they are not two different lesions.
No.
You asked for a follow-up.
You're tricking us.
The mama came back in your office with the child as you requested. After 4 months, she's there in her appointment. And that now this is what you get. So tell me, Sebastiano.
Nothing. Pretend not to have seen it.
Yeah. No, you cannot pretend anymore. That's why it's not in the options. You could pretend the first time, but now you cannot pretend.
I will go with pretend in the first time.
Yeah.
Which brings us perfectly to what Konstantinos said. So, Taman, what do you think it was finally?
Spitz.
Spitznevus. As you knew, from the very beginning. Eh? So, but at the moment that you have in front of you this thing, especially if you couple it with a quite nice stressed mama, then, I mean, what are your options? To say, ah, come on, no, go. No, you will excise it. And practically, this is something that we tested and we in our database, and we found that this is the case, that many times when we decided to follow up a speech nevus in children, not always, but many times, eventually we excised it. And in all these scenarios, the lesion was finally a speech nevus. So that's why these tumors are so fascinating. So I will skip a few slides. All of them were nevi. So follow-up, in fact, decreased our specificity for speech nevi, because at baseline, we were correct to classify them as speech nevi. At follow-up, in 20% of them, we excised them because we became afraid because of their evolution. So theoretically, we should ignore them. We should, at baseline, we should say, okay, it's a speech nevus, bye-bye. We don't want to see it again because it will confuse me.
Emilio, if you go back to, for a moment to the evolution of this lesion, this is also, this observation was also very nice explanation why 10 to 20% of speech nevi look like melanoma. You know, because go back to the original case, and you will see that. I mean, of course, now we see the baseline picture, but just forget the baseline picture for a moment. If you see just for the first time a little child with a lesion like this, you say this is morphologically a melanoma. But since you know that melanoma before puberty is an exceptional scenario, you have to excise it, but you know that most probably it will be a speech nevus, and this belongs to the 20% of speech nevi resembling melanoma during before puberty.
Absolutely. And the very last case, and then we enrich the discussion even more, is this one, very, very quickly. So baseline, okay, first follow-up, last follow-up, and here the diagnosis was speech nevus with atypia, so something like atypical speech tumor. And now we will not start the discussion about sentinel lymph node biopsy if there is an indication. We will just give the answer that according to the data we have up to date, there is no indication for sentinel lymph node biopsy when you have the diagnosis of an atypical speech tumor. So the only thing we need to do is to make sure that the lesion was excised completely with, if possible, with a margin. So not very narrow, but it should be, let's say, an adequate excision with half a centimeter, for example, at least. And then that's all. And of course, follow up prospectively.
Yeah.
Wonderful. So Konstantinos, I think that you also have to contribute to share a case or not.
Yes, I do. And actually, I think it's a nice addition to what you just discussed. Okay, so you can see my screen?
Yes.
There is a very nice question, by the way. Can I tell you? Speechoid nevus in children increase the risk of further melanoma in adult age?
No.
There's no data.
Yeah.
Okay. Is pigmented speech nevus more common than non-pigmented in speech in childhood? My answer is yes.
Depending also, of course, on the population, I guess. I mean, in our populations, yes, pigmented speech nevi are more frequent, but maybe in other populations, it's not the case.
Yeah. I love using the term reed nevus when can I call a speech reed and so on? What is the difference?
Freedom, whenever you like.
Yes.
Freedom.
Yes. Say reed, which was very jealous about Sophie Spitz, decided to publish his paper on this particular nevus, which is, let's say, very similar, but just histologically a little bit different So there are again two schools. One school is bringing the two Nevi together in one family, and another school saying, okay, Spitznevus traditionally is composed by epithelioid and spindle cell nests of melanocytes, while reed nevus is only composed by spindle cells nests of melanocytes. That's why there is a little bit of difference, but in my view, it's really the same.
So it was just because Reed wanted to also to give his name in a nevus, as I also want to do, but I mean, I'm completely unsuccessful for the moment. I will keep trying. But no, I don't need the nevus. For me, even a small
also,
sign is...
Also sign.
No, but we did, but last season, we found something together with Penelope, I think.
The Lala sign.
So...
This is also nice. How long... do the Spitznevian children, which are not excised, take to regress completely? It's very variable. It could happen in 1 year, or it could happen even in 5 years. Usually, that's, in my view, the range. I don't know your opinion, guys.
From my experience? No, go ahead, Emilius.
1 to 5 years.
2 to 5.
I generally exercise and cannot wait for that.
So you don't know.
Usually, I think 2 to 4 years in my experience, and at the end, they take a beautiful reticular pattern if you have the patience to wait for it. But until then, you undergo the stress every 6 or 12 months.
There is a question if we should follow the algorithm despite asymmetry before puberty. No, in the algorithm, the first box was, if the lesion is asymmetric, you excise it, irrespectively of the age. So, of course, symmetry is very, very important, irrespectively of the age. So if the lesion is asymmetric, you excise it.
Doriana is also saying something interesting. Sending a node after excision of an atypical Spitznevus is not recommended even in adults? No, it's not recommended even in adults. Yeah.
Because it's
to
not...
understand. Yeah.
Because it's not predictive of a poor prognosis. So even if it's positive, then it does not mean anything. It does not have any prognostic significance at all. So that's why it doesn't make sense.
Yes.
Okay, Konstantinos, maybe you go with your cases and we see again after this if there are additional questions.
Of course, by all means. You can see my screen?
Not yet, no. But it's coming. I'm sure it's coming. Yes.
Okay. Perfect.
It's okay.
Okay, so female in her early 40s presents for evaluation of some lesions on her torso and extremities that started appearing on her 30s. This one lesion, this is the clinical, this is the dermoscopy.
No, Konstantinos, there is no image.
No.
Your slides are not good.
There is only the first slide appearing.
Yeah, the first slide.
The following.
To share my entire screen to see if it's better now.
Yes.
Yeah, it's okay now.
Yes.
Perfect. So this is the clinical, this is the dermoscopy. And Sebi, can you bring up the question?
Benign or malignant?
Benign or malignant.
This is reminding to the second episode.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Looks benign.
Yes.
Benign for 84. Yeah.
Okay. Perfect. Debbie?
Yes, I would say benign.
Emilios?
Yes, because here I rather think that I see globules and not pseudopods.
Yeah,
maybe some tear globules, but yes, globules, I agree. Absolutely. Nisa?
I agree. Looks benign.
Perfect. Another lesion close to it. This is the non-polarized dermoscopy, and this is the polarized.
But you didn't tell us it was benign before.
Okay. Maybe.
No. There is a story. There is a story.
There's a story building up.
Sorry.
So benign or malignant? This one.
Yeah.
Should we wait?
Concerned about this one, malignant. Yeah.
Okay, malignant, perfect.
Malignant.
Zeppi?
Or Spitzoid, yeah.
Okay.
Definitely is a very atypical lesion, definitely.
Excise?
Yes.
Emilios?
Mm-hmm. Of course, yes.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Excision.
And this is the hand of the patient. Some more lesions. All a little bit, you know, fuzzy. Are those lesions benign or malignant?
What? Konstantinos? What of them?
The last one here or both?
Both of them.
Okay. So then, here people are in the middle, you know, because they don't follow anymore your story and they are waiting for the solution.
Exactly. Some more lesions from the same.
Che bello. Comparison approach.
Mm.
Some more lesions from the same.
They all look like
I start to understand. I start to understand.
What you are showing us, some more from the same patient. And so, Konstantinos, you have more than 100 spitz needles then.
With one person.
I completed my 100 with this person.
This is a very unique case, very unique.
And but, this is the clinical.
I can see the scars. I can see the scars.
The patient. Yeah.
Many were excised, by the way.
Yes, many were excised. And actually, this is a large scar. This is the only case in literature until now that developed a spitzoid melanoma.
But eventually, this is the let's say, the word by the pathologist. Is the patient still alive?
Yes.
Okay, so then, you know.
Yeah.
Yes.
But what about the second lesion that you showed with the shiny white streaks? This one?
Was it excised?
No, it wasn't. Because the patient is one of the 28 cases reported in literature with eruptive disseminated spitz nevi. She had several lesions with shiny white lines. So we took a more conservative approach. This is a rare case. So first described as eruptive juvenile melanoma, and eruptive disseminated spitz nevi is the rarest clinical variant of spitz nevi. This is a beautiful paper by Francesco Ricci. Ricci, am I saying it correct?
Ricci.
Who actually reviewed the entire literature and found all 26 cases reported to date. And there was actually two more, which I'm going to discuss. And I think this is a very interesting paper published in 2020, where actually they did a genetic analysis of a patient with eruptive disseminated spitz nevi. And what they found is that they found the exact same mutation on all three spitz nevi biopsied from this patient, which was a TMP3 ROS1 fusion. And what they discuss here is that this is a metastasis of a benign tumor as a pathogenesis mechanism, which I found really interesting, actually. And this was my case.
Yeah, but this makes sense similarly to what we were discussing about the sentinel lymph node positivity of these tumors. I mean, this is a kind of metastasis, but in the sense that there is some deposition of melanocytes somewhere else than the primary tumor, but eventually does not have the potential to kill the patient, the potential. So it's under control in the end.
That's why I said this is a continuum of your slides, because I'm sure that if we do a sentinel lymph node biopsy in this patient, most likely we'll find melanocytes. But it belongs.
Hmm? Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Wonderful case. But guys, what about the promo? Should we do it now or we wait for?
Yeah. Let's just finish the discussion and then we do so atypical speech tumor in the adult, enlargement only without sending lymph nodes. Yes, correct. Margin for common speech nevus compared to atypical speech lesion. Well, for common speech, there is no required margin. For atypical speech tumors, 5 millimeters to 1 centimeter. Let's say minimum 5 millimeters. Is there a junctional atypical speech nevus?
Nowadays, yes.
Yes.
There wasn't, but in nowadays, after the publication of the new blue book
guidelines.
Yeah, the guidelines from the WHO. Many more common speech nevi should be considered atypical, even the type of junctional, very common, let's say, traditionally common speech nevi. So if
now
there
you
are
gave,
some.
Yeah. You gave a nice idea. The WHO classification of tumors must be one of the topics of one of the episodes. We will
yes.
have so much fun.
Yeah.
So much fun.
and so many curses from the WHO people, but yeah.
Can you please explain again the difference between read and speech? Jeppy, that's yours.
Okay. So it's an histologic difference, not clinical, not dermoscopical. So we can find a Starburst pattern in a speech or in a read nevus. So it's just histological. And histologically, when you see only spindle-shaped melanocytes, this is read nevus. If you find a combination of spindle cells and epithelioid cells, then this is a speech nevus.
And read nevus is always pigmented, I think. There is not a non.
And read nevus is always pigmented.
Read nevus is always flat because the growth is horizontal, but in speech nevus, it's vertical, so it's nodular.
But, you know, I really think it's just a confusion. What historically was proposed is not true. So I showed you the last case. You saw the lesion was a purely flat lesion, junctional at the beginning, and then it became a nodule. So I think that these two entities are just so are the same thing, more or less, variants of the same thing. And all these discussions.
Remember that dermatologists are very, let's say, narcissistic persons. So they like to give names to diseases.
Yes.
That's why we have many names published there. In books, you find in books many names for the same disease. So that's why we are struggling with all these variations, but these are just phenotypes.
Debbie, that's why I'm laughing, because if you look at the question that came, is what is Clark nevus? And like, this is a topic on its own, like in another episode.
Clark nevus, of course, Clark nevus is, by the definition of Benny Ackerman, the most common type of acquired nevus, which is the so-called dysplastic nevus, as it was originally described by Clark, who was the big enemy, by the way, of Benny Ackerman. So Benny Ackerman decided to give to Clark the, let's say, the honor to give a name to a nevus, despite the fact he was his big enemy.
What about Una nevus, Mischer nevus,
Una and Mischer nevus? Yes, Una and Mischer are two types of dermal nevi, so small congenital nevi. Yeah. Meyerson with eczematous halo and Sutton with vitiligo halo.
Are you jealous?
Very jealous. Very
come on. Yeah. No Argentiano nevus yet. No Argentiano nevus yet.
No.
But you have time, Jeppy.
Yeah.
We will support you.
I have 14 years still.
14.
It's a lot.
Wonderful. So
bene.
Go,
ragazzi. Allora, before going to Nisa for the Facebook cases. I like to present you, by the way, this couple of slides, which I like very much, because these are things that I learned just very recently. So the fact that not only UV light is responsible for damaging of the skin, but also the so-called blue light, which is in the spectrum of the visible light, but just after, immediately after UV light. So UVB is going from 290 to 320 nanometers, UVA 320, 400, and blue light 400, 450. But this also, blue light is about 50% of the is giving to the skin the 50% of the total skin oxidative damage. So it's a very highly oxidative type of wavelength, and that's why it's very important to know it, because it's traditionally we know that we have to protect our skin from UV. In the past, we thought only UVB because it's giving the sunburn, but also nowadays we know that also UVA is able to give DNA damaging of the keratinocytes. But now we know that also blue light is responsible for some of the damage because of this oxidative property of blue light. And that's why we need to know that nowadays we have sunscreens which are, let's say, devoted to the, protection throughout all this spectrum of different wavelengths of the sunlight, which is UVA, UVB, and blue light. And this is called triazor, okay? Emilio?
Wonderful, wonderful. Not Emilio, Sebastiano. Sebastiano, where
Sebastiano!
Nisa time.
Yeah. Thank you. Coming.
Nisa time.
So
there we go.
Now, here is the first case. I shared this case around maybe 7 or 8 years ago, and it's an interesting lesion. It's on the ear. The patient is 7-year-old boy, and history is 6 weeks, only 6 weeks.
6 weeks.
And here is a dermatoscopy. When I asked this question, most of the members vote for.
Let's see what would the people vote.
Do you agree? Yeah, most people think that, consider that it was a wart, because the history is 6 weeks, it's rapidly growing, and there are some hemorrhage.
Here. And also here.
Surface.
Also here.
Yeah,
also
here. And also here. But here we have white lines reticular and some dotted vessels, linear vessels, and these crusts are due to the trauma. So we can skip this finding. Just concentrate on the white lines, reticular and dotted vessels, and it's a speech news which grows very, very fastly. The second case.
Quite an angry speech news, very angry.
I would vote like a typical speech or tumor. This is an ugly lesion.
Of course, clinically.
Fortunately, it's a speech nerve, it's not a speech melanoma. And here, again, I ask these cases on different times. And which one do you think that it's a speech news here?
Only one.
Oh, only one.
There is
very
only
difficult.
One.
Wow. Very difficult.
There is only one speech news here.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
And the rest are melanomas.
We can see the results.
Yeah.
There is one dermatofibroma, I guess.
Yeah, could be. Yeah.
The
winner is number one.
And the winner is the first one. The first one was the speech news, and the rest was dermatofibroma. All of them were dermatofibroma. Especially in fair skin types, dermatofibroma can be a great mimicker of speech news and schizoid melanoma. Yes. So we should be very careful on examination, and we should ask the patient the history, because dermatofibroma has a very long-standing history, and on palpation they are generally very firm and the dermal component is very prominent. But if we are not sure about on these findings and about the history, we should excise all these lesions.
Mm-hmm. But it's there
is a question. Yeah. The case on the ear was excised or shaved?
Of course. Always excisional biopsy I perform. I never perform shave biopsy, because when the lesion is a nodular lesion and melanoma is in my differential diagnosis, I cannot, the histopathologist cannot see the whole breast of thickness. On shave excision, only dermal and superficial dermal and epidermal components can be observed. So we always perform excisional biopsy when there is a suspicion of melanoma. Wonderful. Especially in nodular lesions.
And can you tell us a little about the non-pigmented spits and how to recognize them? Well, the cases that Nisa is showing provide some information. Non-pigmented spits usually displays a pattern of many dotted vessels. That
yeah,
might be
dotted vessels and white lines, reticular.
Go.
It's a quite specific finding. And here you also, you can see the white lines also observed in dermatofibromas. And here, there are two lesions. Can you guess which one is the melanoma? And I asked this case yesterday on Facebook and Instagram
pages. It's clear from the age of the patient.
Yes.
Yes.
both patients are around 41 or 50 years old.
No, right? The one on the left looks like a baby.
Looks like a child.
Yes. No, it's the arm of a lady, and she was 51 years old.
Okay.
And the right side, yeah.
Okay, then the left is more suspicious then.
I will go to the left. Left.
Yeah, of course.
So yeah, for the first one, Konstantinos, you said yes. Melanoma?
Yes, because the right one also
me
has
too.
The...
Me too, I go for the left, yeah.
Okay, the left one, the first one is the melanoma. And when I ask this question, and here is the result of the members, 56% of the voters thought that this is a dermatofibroma.
For the left one?
For the first one, they consider that this is a dermatofibroma. So there can be a really very great similarity. History, palpation, all are very important to decide excision for such lesions. The second one was another dermatofibroma.
Also very, very helpful in this case, if you can go back, Nisa, for a second.
Yeah.
Is that because it's contact polarized, you can see the white. So when you press the dermatofibroma, it turns white because of the scarring.
Yeah.
So
perfect.
On the upper part, this is quite indicative for the diagnosis.
Yeah, agree with you, Konstantinos.
Let's say the message that there is no reason to stress ourselves with nodular dermatofibromas that are a little bit aneurysmatic and these shiny lines in the center. When there is a doubt, we excise it and everything is fine.
Yeah. I asked the second patient previous week, and the age of the patients are very close here. One is melanoma and one is spitznius. You can see the similarity of these cases. They are both located on the leg. And Jeppy, you weren't with us the previous week.
Yes,
so which one do you think that is melanoma
right
here?
The right
melanoma
one.
On the right.
Right.
The one on the right, yeah. The one on the right side is the melanoma. The one on the left side is the spitznius. So
yes,
again, a great similarity. And here is how it grows. The patient is 3 months old,
mm-hmm.
6 months old, and 2 years. This time it looks, very horrible. And I excise at this
Did
point,
it
was really nervous. Yeah, I excise because the mom was so anxious, and she said that, please, doctor, remove this one. And we remove it, and it's a red news.
This is
very interesting. Have a look at.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. And the dermatoscopy and excise. At this point, antihistopathology was sent to two dermatopathologists. One said that this is a melanoma, and the other one said that this is an atypical Spitznius. So we didn't, of course, perform sentinel lymph node biopsy and re-excise the margins with 0.5 millimeter here. So it can change in that way. You can see it here.
How old was the patient?
It's three-year-old.
Three-year-old. And here you can see, and here you can see the problem, which is reflected in the literature. And what is the problem? This is very probably a Spitznius. Very probably.
Yeah.
But of course, if only the first pathologist was giving the diagnosis, this was categorized as a melanoma, a spitzoid melanoma. But this is a fake. This is not the true. This is a melanoma, which is not a melanoma. It's just resembling a melanoma, okay?
Yeah.
The same problem we have clinically, they also have sometimes histologically. So the point is, we have to manage with very care, with a lot of care, a diagnosis of spitzoid melanoma before puberty, because this could be still a very ugly looking Spitznius.
Yeah, I agree. The only problem here is, JP, there was around 15 mitoses and there was also a pedatoid spread, and P16 expression is not very strong as we observed in Spitznius. And FISH analysis couldn't be performed in this case. And nowadays in our department, we perform PRAME stains. Maybe retrospectively, we have to look for PRAME stains in this case. And I will talk with my pathologist to make PRAME stain and see the results here. So, it was very difficult for the pathologist.
On this point.
But this case, and this is my last case, and this is very, very interesting case. 7 years old boy, and this lesion grew very fast in the last 2 months. And they went to a dermatologist, and he said that this is a wart, and he was planning to make a cryotherapy here. But fortunately, they came to our department, and as soon as we'll have a look at the lesion, and here were the differential diagnosis on Facebook dermatoscopy blog. Again, most of the members considered that this is a wart, which is not, of course, a wart. This could be a Spitznius or a spitzoid melanoma here. And the terrible thing is here, this was a spitzoid melanoma. And we asked these histopathologic slides to Austria and Australia as well. And they both think that this is a spitzoid melanoma. But the worst thing was, you can see the lymphovascular invasion here.
Yeah, but what age? What age?
7 year old.
Seven?
7 year old, yeah. And in 2 or 3 months, became like that. It was a nodular lesion. Here you can see the dermatoscopy. You can see the brown clots, dots here, white structures, areas. And some traumatic hemorrhage, blood, crust. It was highly suspicious. And here you can see the lymphovascular invasion here. Sentinel lymph node biopsy was, of course, positive. Then the patient went to undergone to total lymph node dissection. And there was around five metastatic lymph nodes there also. The patient is still living, surviving, and I'm following up. 2 years passed. There's no problem yet, and I wish there will be no problem in the future as well.
Yeah.
So this was my last case. As Emilio said, every nodular spitzoid-looking lesions should be excised even before puberty. We know that melanoma is extremely rare, but it can still happen. So to be on the safe side, we should excise, and we shouldn't perform cryotherapy, cauterization, if we are not sure that it's a wart.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very, very important point. There is a question. If there is an argument to excise early Spitznevi when they are small, and so it's easier to do it,
Yes, there is an argument. I said it, Constantinos told it. Nisa also showed the case that it was the case, that if it was excised earlier, it would be easier. So yes, of course, especially when they are nodular or they start to become nodular. Wonderful. Any other question that we didn't take? Have you ever found any association between neurofibromatosis and spitzoid lesions? Not to my knowledge.
No, that I know of.
No, okay, wonderful. And I think
I have one case of mastocytosis and five spitz needles in one patient.
Okay. One case, yeah. Mm-hmm.
One case.
Wonderful. And I think we are good to go to the next. We are late, but it's okay. We knew it. We go to the next.
It's the episode. It's the topic. It's impossible.
The next session of the episode. Sebi? What is eudermoscopy?
Well, that's a very good question. I think it's a complex answer. Is it an app?
Mm.
Is it a game?
Mm.
Is it a quiz?
Mm-hmm.
Is it an educative,
mm,
entertaining application? It's all of those together.
Right.
It's eudermoscopy. Those are Amelia's words. I'm like copywriting. This is from Greek, but still, I'm stealing his words. In eudermoscopy, you can train. There are 21 levels up to this date.
By the way, 22 is coming out in a very few days.
Okay, looking forward to that. You can play live, where you can either submit your case or examine cases from your colleagues. I think that this is a very good, not only educative tool, but it's also, in essence, a live feedback on your lesions, what to do with them. And you have experts from all across the world, and there must be passionate people looking at your cases and responding to them. So I'm going to present two short cases from this week because it is active. It's going forward. Since last week, we had 30 new cases. So please post your cases. We will be there. We will answer. We'll review your cases. This case is from Italy on the test.
It's from Jeppy.
Of course, it's Jeppy. It's located on the test on a 21-year-old female and present since 10 years.
Hmm.
This is clinical. And this is the dermoscopy.
Hmm.
Ilios?
Yeah, come on.
Looks nice.
Come on.
Debbie?
Well, congenital nevus is my first thinking, and then an old type of spitz nevus. So a spitz nevus which is now going to be stable and...
You know what? When you are asked something and you speak for more than... Yes. What does it mean?
Yes.
He hasn't made up his mind. So I personally voted for nevus, and that was the majority of voters. Some people voted for melanoma, but I think they didn't know the history. So female, 21 years old, and present since the age of 10. So stable lesion, no worries, I think.
Yeah.
And the other case... I think it's quite tricky. I have no idea
what is this. What is this flag? It's Australia or New Zealand?
New Zealand, I suppose, right?
New Zealand, I think. So New Zealand, on the face of a lady, 49 years old, dermoscopy. Unfortunately, we don't have non-polarized because this could be an initiating seborrheic keratosis. Like here, it could be a comedo-like opening, but this is polarized, so we can't be sure. The other obvious diagnosis for me is, Zebi, what is it?
Blue nevus, some kind of intradermal nevus. Or
yeah.
You thought or about
congenital
nevus.
Nevus.
I cannot also exclude BCC if... No, I'm not sure because of the polarization. So maybe it's a little bit more bluish. I don't know.
There's perifollicular hypopigmentation. It looks like an EOS to me.
Show us.
So I personally voted for melanoma because I think that I would cut this out to exclude melanoma. The majority thinks it's an EOS. Some think it's a BCC, but still, a very interesting case. Next time, please upload your non-polarized dermoscopy as well so that we can have the entire picture. And those were the cases from you.
Wonderful. And as you can see, you know, we have a saying in Italy, which is when the bread is hard, it's hard for everybody. So you see that here, it's not very easy to get convincing diagnosis.
This is what I want to comment on before. So Asmar Goob always says and used to say that dermoscopy has cracked the code. So at the beginning, it was nevi or melanomas. And it was either advanced melanomas or obvious nevi. Dermoscopy has revealed to us an entire new world, and especially those borderline lesions that, like Nisa saw before, several of those, that you cannot know. Those could be the true precursors of melanoma, and dermoscopy is the tool to actually get to those. So it's an amazing field that keeps evolving. And I think that's why we're so passionate, and that's why it's on a Sunday at 9 p.m. in Greece, and there are 400 participants here on YouTube. It's a magic world.
Correct.
Absolutely. It's so
very magic. Good.
It's so magic that we are not at all upset anymore for going late. Don't care anymore for being
late. No, we don't care.
We couldn't care less.
Let's say so. We have to make official that the happy hour is not the happy hour anymore. It's the happy and a half.
Happy hour and a half.
Half an hour.
Happy hour and a half. That's nice.
Happy hour and a half.
That's nice. I like it. So we have to show now cases sent from the participants, but I would say that should we skip them, just showing the thing that we have to show, it's obligatory.
Of course.
And then we do the rest next week.
The next episode, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Cases sent from you. We will see them next week, but of course we will see directly now. What?
Penelope.
Our Pascal.
And they are wonderful. They are wonderful. Amazing. Related to the peripheral globules.
Oh, che bello. And we have to wonder. We have to make a decision, right?
So, I mean, let's go quickly. Benign, malignant. Giuseppe, you do the first row, number one.
Number one is malignant.
Two?
Benign.
Three?
Benign.
Okay, Costas the second. Four?
Benign.
Five?
Malignant.
Six?
Benign.
And Nisa the third, seven?
Seven, benign.
Eight?
How old is the patient? Malignant, depends on age.
Nine?
Benign.
Very good. I mean, you did perfect, I think. If I'm not wrong, you did not do any mistakes at all, because it's easy with the globules, guys. It's easy with the globules. I mean, you know, when they are symmetric, we don't care. We don't care when they are symmetric. So, melanoma, the first one. Nevus, the second. Nevus, the third. Nevus, the fourth. Melanoma, the fifth. Nevus, the sixth. Nevus, the seventh. Melanoma, the eighth. And
clonal.
And in addition to this, again, and I'm starting to become jealous now a little bit, Penelope, because in the past you were sending special gifts mainly to me, but now recently you sent always to Nisa.
He's my lovely friend, and we just don't be jealous.
a little bit. And this is a special gift for you, Nisa. We melanoma and the spitz nevus with rosette.
And she also observed rosette, so we can include Pascal to our study.
Exactly. Because we discussed about it last week. Wonderful. So that's perfect. We will see your cases next week together with the new ones that you are going to send. Sebastiano, what's next?
I suppose we... Emiliuccio, but you should say something about...
Yes. Yes.
It's like the lamp lighting above. It's like,
yes, thank you, Jeffy. Thank you so much. You are such a nice guy. Thank you very much. I have to find it now. And the guys. There we go. DL5 comes with everything you need. So, charging base, leather pouch, protective belt case, smartphone adapter, ice cap, and eyepiece. And also magnetically attached ruler and circular markings that can be used to choose the proper place to biopsy. Can you imagine? Fantastic. And of course, also this blue light, this kind of wood lamp that we discussed in the previous episode. So this is a new fascinating tool. It's also a toy and a tool together by Dermlight, the DL5. Wonderful. So that
I have a really nice case with DL5. We'll display it next time.
Okay. I already have one, and the vessels are amazing with DL5. Really.
With the blue light?
No. So it's a functionality alternating between polarized, non-polarized, and cross-polarized.
With the cross-polarized,
Of course.
The scales mainly are very well seen with the cross-polarization.
Like all the epidermal, and especially the platinum corneum, it looks amazing.
But especially the scales. I mean, I think that's the biggest difference. Okay, so now I think that I didn't forget anything else.
No.
Hello, you're good.
Are you interested for, should we stop now? Should we close the episode now?
No, come on. That's the best.
Are you sure?
But you see that before... Kahoot, usually we don't lose anyone, but now, you know, you see that it's 8:15. People are going to have dinner, so we have to move on.
Get ready to join. Smartphones on your hands. www.kahoot.it. This is the pin. Enter your nickname. Don't worry if you get a notification that you cannot get connected. You will get connected as soon as I will start the game. For the moment, we have just 3 players. So everybody will be on the podium.
Yes. Well, this is nice because these are the, let's say, the cream de la creme de la creme.
La creme de la creme.
So, speeds.
So, it looks even worse than the previous time.
Yeah, we had usually 13 or 14 the other time.
13 or 14, yeah. But anyhow, it doesn't matter since as soon as we start, it's going to work, hopefully.
Yeah.
So let's wait 10 more seconds, 9, 8.
By the way, Kasia is not playing.
Why not?
Who was the winner last time? Kasia.
Kasia, of course.
Kasia, of course. Of course. KK.
Okay. So I start, and let's hope that everything will work as usually.
Yes.
Boom. Let's see.
Three, two, one, ignition.
Number one. Do you like this panel?
I love it.
Yeah.
I hate it. They're all worrisome.
Dermoscopy. Are you ready? Are you ready?
Yes.
Which one is not a melanoma?
Okay.
Number one, two, three, or four?
Oh,
and yes, we have a lot of people voting, so everybody was
yes.
Okay. Very good. Wow, we have one of the biggest numbers of people playing today.
Yes, yes. It's until now 176.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Number three. Can you show us again? Can you show us again?
No.
Don't be like that.
Oh, number three. But they were very good, let me tell you.
Yeah.
How can it come?
Wow. Wonderful. Yeah, but come on. Number three is the less ugly as compared to the others.
Yes, okay. But still. Yeah.
Still, it was excised, of course. That's why.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Very good. So, Spitz. Yes,
Spitz, come on. Spitz deserves the first rank.
Absolutely. Number two. So, with number two, we will do a small game. I will show you only the clinical. We will vote, but it doesn't count for the points.
Mm-hmm.
Just vote based on the clinical if you think that this lesion is benign or malignant.
Okay.
Do you have the music? I do, but you don't.
We don't.
So we have 74 voting for benign and 100 voting for malignant, which makes sense in my view clinically. Now, no points here, don't worry. So now you see dermoscopy. And now we will answer to the question.
Yeah.
Which is your specific diagnosis? So do you think that this is a nevus, a melanoma, a seborrheic keratosis, or a squamous cell carcinoma? You like it?
I like it. I have my answer.
And the answer now, the most voted answer is seborrheic keratosis, which is the correct answer.
Ragazzi, we have an exceptional audience.
Let me tell you.
These are not very easy cases.
But I can say that, this is quite impressive because this is not, today we know how irritated seborrheic keratosis looks like more or less, but still this is not an easy case for sure. Absolutely. And now we have Spitz.
Still Spitz, but very close. Spitz. Gianpaolo. Gianpaolo is my resident.
Ah, hey. Bravo, Gianpaolo.
Gianpaolo is struggling to win once.
Very good. Question number three.
By the way, I have a hunch of who is Spitz, but I don't want to disclose it.
No points. Don't worry. Which of the following wines comes from Spain? Chardonnay, Porto, Amarone, or Rioja?
Come on. I know as well, you know. So without knowing the basics, I know it, you know. Come on.
We still have to work. Yes. Yeah. So we'll do it little by little every week. We will improve also concerning wines. No points here, no worries. Next, another panel.
Uh-huh.
Four lesions, clinically, dermatoscopically.
Okay.
And now, which one is the melanoma? It's number one, number two, number three, or number four?
I see. I have my vote.
Do you?
I have my vote.
Are you confident? Yes.
Well, reasonably.
Okay.
So am I.
Really? Was your answer the same with the audience answer?
Yeah.
Wonderful. I did not expect this, this quantity of correct answers.
Yeah.
So we are getting used to the idea that the globules are not so bad. We don't care so much. Yeah,
good guys.
Yeah, good guys. While the first one was the melanoma. Wonderful, excellent, fantastic. Which brings still Spitz.
And Paolo, only 9 points. It's so
nine
close.
Points. Oh, very close.
Your resident.
Very
this
close.
Must be milliseconds, eh?
see. Milliseconds.
Very good. Question number four. Clinical. Dermoscopy.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. What do you mean, okay? Do you know what it is?
No. But we wait for your question.
So my question is this is a pleomatrichoma, true or false?
Oh, this is a nice question.
Tough one.
Nice question.
True or false?
I have my answer. False.
No, it's true.
It's true, of course. And show the picture again.
Yes.
If I do the striking, probably
white.
The white area.
The calcification here.
Calcification.
Yeah. But the point is that this is a tough pleomatrichoma because the majority of them, white color really predominates. So it's all over the lesion. In this case, not so much. But there are also pleomatrichomas like this one. It was a tough.
And did you recognize that with the plate of the dermatoscope, these white structures move in pleomatrichoma?
Yes, because they are very, very, you know, very hard, very, very rigid.
Gianpaolo,
Gianpaolo is the first. Spitz voted for false. Can you imagine?
Yes. Okay, question. Okay. Would you biopsy that lesion?
This lesion does not exist anymore. It's in the histopathologic laboratory.
Jeppe, probably Dylan is my resident.
Oh, you see.
So, question number four, still, no points. So we said that we speak about wines and we speak about what else? Philosophy, always.
Philosophy, yeah.
So that's the next question. Who said this? It is better to change an opinion than to persist in a wrong opinion. Michael Jackson, Donald Trump, Socrates, or Jeppy?
Okay, how possible is that Donald Trump could have said that?
No way. But then Michael Jackson is not very...
Jeppy, you got 32 votes.
Bravi, thank you, my friends. Thank you. Much more than Donald Trump and Michael Jackson.
Much more.
You're a larger star than them.
By the way, this was a very nice quote. We should be at any time flexible to change our opinions because it's very probable that we are wrong, even if we think that we know too much. It's still very probable that there are even more things that we don't know.
And not only that, it's a matter of it's a sign of maturation. Like changing your opinion is a sign that you learn more, you adjust to the environment. I don't change my opinion.
Of course, not every day, but from time to time.
From time to time. Once in a month, let's say so.
Once in a month.
In the chat, Zoe wrote that Jeppy is always right.
That's what he added. Wonderful. Last question. So this is the first time we play this type of question. So now I will show you also dermoscopy, and then you will need to write on your telephone with letters the correct answer for this lesion. So this is clinical, this is dermoscopy, and now you have to type the answer. Type the answer.
Wow, this is extremely, this is really very, very, very bad.
No.
PhD looks like pathogenic granuloma.
Think about it.
Yeah, of course. I mean, there are a couple of options, but very nice. And if you write it also with a spelling error, it's out.
I don't know. I'm not so sure.
We'll find out.
So, top 20 answers.
Oh.
Wow. Eccrine poroma. Correct answers are 21 poroma correct answers and 3 eccrine poroma correct answers. Fantastic.
Ma bravi. Ma bravissimi, ragazzi. Mamma mia, mamma mia.
Podium.
A3M.
And Gianpaolo!
Wow, Gianpaolo! Congratulations! You did it, Gianpaolo! Show your face! Show your face! Wow! Can you imagine? Gianpaolo is just second year resident.
Really?
Perfect! Yes. Amazing! New Kesia.
Yes.
Second year. Okay, so she doesn't need the rest 2 years, three.
No, it doesn't look. Hey! Bravo, Gianpaolo!
I told you, Jetty.
Every Monday he's saying, don't worry, I will make it.
It's thanks to you because you're the best, and I learned everything from you. I don't know what to say.
Gianpaolo, you are even better than me because I didn't think about Ekrim Poroma here.
Me, yes. Because of the colorate. Thank you.
Bravo,
Gianpaolo.
Bravo.
You're the best teacher I had in my life.
Grazie. Un bacione. Gianpaolo, ciao.
Wonderful.
Bene.
Also a nice moment at the end there.
Hey, very good, very good.
I mean, you see how sweet he was with you. That shows something.
Yes.
Wonderful, guys.
Bene, ragazzi. Bene.
What an episode.
Yeah, this was really legendary.
I think we should always choose this kind of, you know, controversial topics.
Yeah.
Very good. Allora, ragazzi, let's go to dinner. Enjoy, and see you next Sunday, 7 p.m. Un bacione, Seppi.
Thank you all.
Thank you all for being with us.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.